tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. Gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open.
Every 15 minutes, someone in the U.S. dies due to an alcohol-related incident. 28 of your peers were randomly selected to represent if every 15 minutes someone died in this closed environment. As you saw yesterday, the students were pulled out of class on a stretcher, their faces painted white, and were cut off from communication with the community, their families, and their friends. They did not return home last night either. The students were brought to a hotel where they went through team-building exercises, two speakers, and they wrote letters to their families as if they had one last opportunity to speak to them. This has been a long, emotional, but rewarding process for them. As the assembly continues, I ask a few things of you. Please put yourself in the situation. As you hear the speakers speak, as you see your peers speak, as you see the slideshows run, think about what it would be like without them. As the assembly goes on, we ask that you find respect in yourself for the people who participated in this program. Lastly, I ask you that after today, you go home with an open mind. We all understand that underage drinking will never just stop, and that after this assembly, we know that teenagers will continue to drink. What we want for you guys is to just make a smart decision and to understand the consequences of drinking and driving, and hopefully you guys will make the right decision in a bad situation. I'd now like to invite the victims that were a part of this program.
Alex DeStefano, Anthony Iarussi, Vicky LaGuardia, Doug Maslow, Bridget Cristinino, Logan Turner, Jess Matera, John Schmadel, Mark Ripley, McKenna Cutsup, Reed Harrison, Alyssa Palamini, Alyssa Cranston, Olivia LeBeau, Sean Hayner, Peter Messler, Rachel Henderzak, Jason Pagano, Alyssa Giannone, Mike Tribuna, Matt Doyle, Rob Greasy, Jen Learn, Steph Cataldo, Christine Paul Castro, Rob Peterson, Lauren Wagner, Mr. Hess, and Mrs. DiMaggio.
At this time, we're going to watch a clip to recap what happened yesterday.
Alex DeStefano, Vicky LaGuardia, Anthony Iarussi,
Lauren Wagner, Logan Turner,
Alyssa Palamini,
Christine Paul Castro,
Mark McKenna Cutsup,
Alyssa Cranston, Jason Pagano,
Alyssa Gino, Mike Tribuna, Stephanie Cataldo, Doug Maslow, Reed Harrison,
Robert Peterson.
If I saw you in heaven, would it be the same?
Jess and her friends decided to sneak into the mountainside pool.
Alex made the mistake of putting her drink down to go to the bathroom.
Robert and Lauren were driving home from band practice when a drunk driver struck them when leaving the high school.
Was out with her softball friends after celebrating the season.
Alyssa and her friends went down the shore for Memorial Day weekend.
Reed was on his way home from a basketball game when he was struck by a drunk driver going 65 miles an hour. However, on Saturday night, the driver got caught up in the moment and ended up drinking as well. The driver told everyone that she felt better and was okay to drive. When his vehicle was struck by an intoxicated driver on a side street in Mountainside. Reed could not control the car swerving into oncoming traffic. He lost control of the car and swerved into two other cars. He was brought to the hospital with a broken arm and a shattered femur. After running a red light, she hit a family of four head-on.
It was raining when they left the party on the highway. Logan lost control of the car, flipping over the guardrail. Paramedics rushed to the scene, and both were rushed to the hospital.
Because he did not have his seatbelt on, was flown from the car and found 15 feet in front of the car. He was pronounced dead at the scene. The driver fled the scene and Matthew was pronounced dead in the emergency room that day. When the police got to the scene, she was found lifeless.
By the time they got to the hospital, Logan was already dead.
Reed was in critical condition when the police and EMS arrived, but was pronounced dead before ever reaching the hospital. Splitting her head open, she died of massive blood loss.
She was instantly paralyzed and drowned in the pool. Later that night, Sean was thrown up and choked on his own vomit and died.
Doug will be greatly missed by his sister, Christina, and his parents. She leaves behind six close friends, her sister Megan, brother Matthew, and her parents. Anthony will be remembered for playing on the baseball team and being a loyal member to Trent. He will be greatly missed by his sister Alexia and his mother and father. She will be remembered for her contributions to the Link Crew, the youth group, and will be terribly missed by her friends, Maggie, Julia, Morgan, Maria, and her brothers Michael and Kevin, and her parents.
Logan had plans to go to Duke University and will be missed by his friends Luke and Logan. He also leaves behind his brother Dylan and his parents. She leaves behind her two brothers, Michael and Brian, her parents, and her longtime boyfriend, Whitey.
Alyssa leaves behind her brother and best friend, Justin, her friends Sarah, Maddie, and Olivia, and her parents. It's by his sister Caitlin, his mom, and his dad.
When a child dies from an alcohol-related incident, they don't always get the chance to say goodbye to their families simply because it's unexpected. Last night at the hotel, we asked the students to write a letter to their family and friends as if they were given one more opportunity to say goodbye. We asked a few of those students and one teacher to share those letters with us. Bridget Christianino, could you come up?
Dear Mom and Dad, I love you more than words can describe. I honestly think that I am the luckiest girl. The opportunities you have given me and your endless amount of encouragement made me realize that life is truly an exceptional thing. A life without meaning or direction is what I consider failure and disappointment to be. You are what gave my life direction and helped me to figure out my purpose. Every time I sang, you gave me applause. Every time I felt stressed, you gave me perspective. Every time I cried, you gave me love, and every time I felt afraid, you gave me a hand to squeeze. I'm sorry for all of the times I caused you to worry about me, grow upset, or take time out of your day to fix a foolish mistake I made. Even though I know you would say that all of that are just responsibilities of a parent, I still want you to know how much I appreciate that. In everything you do for me, I see love. I saw love when you made my favorite dinner after Sadie died. I saw love when you honestly told me that you support my desire to be a musical theater major. I saw love when you ran into my room every 15 minutes during nights when I was sick. And I'm sure every single person sees love in your eyes when you're at my funeral. I think that the most important thing you have taught me is love. I'm not afraid or sad to die because I know that even though my life was short, it was filled with love. Not everyone is able to say that. Tell my friends that the amazing memories they have given me in my 17 years are more than I could ask for in an entire lifetime. There are so many different songs I could quote right now, but I would hate to show favoritism. Instead, I just ask that you not cry because of the limited time I had, but instead remember me in my entirety. Remember my hopes, my dreams, my faults, my tantrums, and my lame jokes. But most of all, remember my love and continue to let that love grow by sharing it in every way you can. There will be another time when we will meet again, so do not waste any precious time on showing sorrow. Forever and always, Bridget.
Next, we're going to have Mike Tribuna read his letter to his parents.
Dear Mom and Dad, over the 17 wonderful years I was alive, you guys taught me something that is more important than anything, family. You were both there for me whenever I needed you. I learned everything from you guys. Dad, I look up to you more than anyone I know. You are one of the best guys I've ever met, and you've taught me so many amazing qualities. One of the best memories I have with you is waking up every morning at 7 a.m. on Saturdays just so I could go watch you play basketball. Also, those years you sacrificed your time to be able to coach my sports teams. My favorite thing was the long car rides and my games so we could strategy and we could improve my game. Mom, you're the heart and soul of our family. Without you, our family would be who we are today. I still remember when I couldn't sleep and you would get out of my bed and stick me in the car and you'd drive me around the blocks just so I could fall asleep. My favorite thing was to wake up and run and jump into your bed and give you a big hug and kiss. Can you please tell Tori and Chris that I'll miss them so much and I'll always think of them and tell them I'm sorry. I love them both very much. If you could also tell my friends that they were the greatest kids I know. They always had my back wherever they were always there for me. Without my friends, I would be lost. No matter what, they could cheer me up. I have some of the best memories with them. Lastly, can you tell all my family members and friends that I'll miss them and love them so much? I'm truly sorry for my selfish behavior. I didn't mean for this to happen. I just thought it would never happen to me. I love you guys so much. I will miss you more than you guys can ever imagine. Love always, your son, Mike.
Next, we're going to hear from Mrs. DiMaggio writing to her family.
Dear John, you have the best part of me with you still, our son John, and our daughter Anne Marie. Being your wife has been an incredible journey. Every day, remember every day that I am in love with you, and I'm always in your heart. Being your best friend was one of the greatest gifts God has given me. We've made a remarkable team, and I love the family and life we made together. Always your wife, Leela. John, my first child, my only son, always know I'm with you. I have so much love for you. You make me proud. You are one of the two best things I've done in my life. I gave you life so you could live it, so go out and live each day to its fullest. Talk to me often, just look in the mirror and you'll see me because your eyes are my eyes. Help Dad out and protect your sister. I will always love you, Mom. Anne Marie, my sweet baby girl, always remember what I say. You are beautiful on the inside and the outside. I love you very much and I am so sorry I will not be able to help you through the girly parts of life. But I promise that when you close your eyes and talk to me, I will help you. I am always with you. I am a part of you, your soul and your spirit. I gave you life to live, so go out and live each day like it's your last. By the way, you are going to make a great wife and a phenomenal mother someday. Be kind to Daddy, be patient with your brother, and always defend him. My heart overflows with love for you, Mommy.
And last, we're going to hear from Logan Turner.
To my friends, I'm sorry for leaving you all behind. There were so many memories that we could have made if we had more time. I wish I could go back and change things, change the mistake, change the decision, but I can't. What's done is done, and because of it, I am gone forever. No more hanging out, no more messing around. The memories that we have already made are all we will ever have, all you will be able to remember me by. It is my fault, no one else's. I'm truly sorry I took away the moments we would have had together that will now never happen. Whatever you go on to do, it will be without me, because I made the decision to drink and drive. I love each and every one of you from the bottom of my heart. There's nothing I can say to make it better, but I hope you can all learn from my mistake and make the right choice so nobody else has to go through this. Luke, Logan, I had a great time growing up with you guys, and I'll cherish the time we were able to spend together. To my teammates, I wish you the greatest successes in your lives. To the ones who are always there for me, and to those who I was always there for, I beg that you think of me whenever you need someone to lean on, and I'm sorry I won't be there to help. Love always, your friend. To my brother, Dylan, even though we used to butt heads, you know I always loved you. I need you to stay strong for Mom and Dad. I'm sorry I won't be at your graduation, I won't see you at your wedding, and I'll never meet your children. I wish we had more time to become as close as I know we could have been. Love always, your brother. To my parents, Mom and Dad, I know I messed up, and I know it's my fault. I never wanted to hurt either one of you in any way, and I know this pain will be unforgettable and unforgivable. I'm sorry you won't see me graduate from Duke. I'm sorry I will never give you any grandchildren. Because of you two, I had the opportunity to do something great with my life, but I threw it away for one night. I can't say enough about how much you both mean to me. Every second we ever spent together was too short, and I wish I had just one more. Love always, your son.
All right, thanks, guys. Next, we're going to talk to Detective Huber, who was the coordinator for the whole program.
Over the last 32 hours, we've taken friends, brothers, sisters, children, acquaintances away from the communities of Mountainside and Berkeley Heights in an attempt to open up people's eyes. As quickly as we took them, is as quickly as life-changing incidents can happen. Each and every day we lose somebody as a result of drugs and alcohol. In our attempt to run this program, we could have never done it without the full support of not only the Berkeley Heights and Mountainside communities, the Governor Livingston community, as well as the Berkeley Heights and the Mountainside Police Departments. This program, it's the third time that we've run it in 6 years. If we open one person's eyes, we've done our job with this program. You need to realize that this program, though we were involved, was solely run by your fellow students because they believe there is a problem. This is one of the most crucial times of the year, with graduation, with proms. And we were fortunate enough to run this program in a controlled environment. The students that we took for the 32 hours, at the end of the day today, will get their cell phones back, will go home, and this will be a memory. They'll have a second chance. We don't want somebody in this audience, somebody within our communities, to be a statistic and to make that one wrong decision. Our cemeteries, our jails, are filled with people that made that one wrong decision. Above all, we don't want somebody here to be a statistic within the Mountainside and Berkeley Heights community. I want to thank Matt, Kat, Carolyn, Cass, Billy, Rubino. They were the six that since September have been working tirelessly to make this program work and to put this program together. Without them and their dedication, we wouldn't be here today. So I personally, Detective D'Elia and Detective Stallone, want to thank you guys for your dedication to your peers, but most importantly to the community. We're fortunate enough. We've done something different with this year's Days of Realization. We've incorporated a program called Project Pride. Project Pride is run by an individual named Michael Ritter. And we would not be able to have Project Pride here if it weren't for Mark Cranston, the Chief of Staff for the Department of Corrections. So without further ado, I want to introduce Michael Ritter.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. You know, sometimes when people make destructive choices, bad decisions, they don't die. They actually go to prison. Presently today, we have over 23,000 men and women that are now incarcerated or locked up in our state. And yes, the majority of people are there with drug and alcohol-related offenses, but you know what? It all comes down to, as you saw today, as you're hearing, about choices, about the importance of making good, healthy choices, and not just when mom and dad are around or the detectives or the police department, but every single second of the day. And as the detective was saying, just how fast your life can change. But you know what? You don't have to just take my word for it or their word for it. Right now, we're gonna hear from three people that did not make good decisions. Let's open up the curtain. As you heard, this is a program called Project Pride. What you're about to see is 100% real. Nothing is fake, nothing is scripted, nothing is phony. In fact, when we're finished here this afternoon, the three presenters, Mitchell, Faith, and Jessica, will have to go back with the corrections officers, Officer Jadis and Officer Lamro, that are present here today. And as you're gonna hear from them firsthand, they grew up in communities just like yours. They come from families just like yours. They had big goals, big dreams, and this was not in their plans. Yet, going back to that word, choices, because they made some destructive choices in their lives that started right here in high school, these people are now presently incarcerated. Now, we talked about earlier, I heard the students that were selected, they had to give up their cell phones and their iPods and their iPads and all that stuff. In prison, you don't have any of that. You know, mom and dad cannot bring you up your cell phone or your iPad. They can't even bring you up your own clothes. Like if you see what the presenters are wearing today, and this is not to disrespect or embarrass the speakers, but this is what's real. It does not matter what type of town that you come from, the color of your skin, where you went to school, how much money mom and dad have, right? Here's the thing. Once someone comes through our doors, that very first second, all right, they're greeted not only by the two officers here, but a whole team of officers, and a box is placed in front of them. And the officers tell them, take off all your belongings, put everything in this box, your clothes, your cell phone, your jewelry, your hat, everything, and it's shipped off. You're then issued a pair of state socks, state shoes, state pants, state shirt, and state underwear. And that's what someone must wear for the entire duration of their prison sentence. Mom and dad can never bring you up anything, your teachers, your counselors, the police officers, nothing. You can't have anything on a holiday, you can't have anything on a birthday. And these are just really a few of the many, many consequences that these three people are now faced with every single day, again, going back to choices. We're really honored to be here today, and the three presenters that you're about to hear from have volunteered to participate in this program, meaning they were not forced to come out here by the officers. They're not getting paid to do this. They don't get any time off their prison sentence, so it's not like by coming out here to speak, they get to go home early or anything like that. And I think as all of us can appreciate, this takes a lot of courage for someone to stand up. This is a large group of people, but they're gonna share some stuff that hopefully will have an impact on your life and the choices that you make. Now the first presenter, his name is Mitchell. And Mitchell, growing up, big time athlete, played sports, played soccer, played baseball, actually graduated from high school, went on to college, had big goals and big dreams. But unfortunately, back when he was in high school, he started to make some poor choices, and one night it all caught up to him. Where now, if you're sitting here as a senior, where's the seniors at in the audience by show of hands? Everybody? Okay. Mitchell has been in prison since all of you have been in the sixth grade. He's been in prison now for the past 6 years plus. He's now serving a 10-year prison sentence at the Albert C. Wagner Correctional Facility in Bordentown, New Jersey. Like I said earlier, he volunteered to come out and share his message. Let's give Mitchell a really nice round of applause. Mitchell.
So, This is a really somber experience for me. I've just sat on the other side of the curtain, and I listened to what you guys were doing up here on the stage, and it really hit me because 2 weeks ago, a close family friend, 18-year-old kid named Justin, and his friend Steven, they were in a bad car accident, wrecked their car. Justin died. He was 18 years old. And just seeing this casket right here, I wish I could have been at his funeral, but in prison, you really can't go to their funeral. They'll bring you there just to view the body, but I couldn't be there. And it just stunned me because this young kid that I had grown up with, even though I'm a little bit older, he was a friend of the families. I used to see him grow up, and I see him grow up, and now he's 18 years old. And I never thought during his time in prison that I would never see him again. The other kid, Steven, he's 19. He's on critical life support, and he could die at any minute. So yeah, this is just as real for me as it is for y'all. I know you guys got prom coming up, right? Prom? Just drive safely out there, please. Y'all need to come back because you're going to go on to do big things. Like Mr. Mike said, my name is Mitchell. I've been in prison since I was 20 years old. I'm going to tell you my story from how I went from your age. Actually, I was a little bit younger when I started messing up. But sitting where you're sitting to how I got up here. I went to school like you guys. I had a mother that loved me. Father was there for me. I played sports. I liked it. But for me, I started getting distracted from those things when I was about 12, 13 years old. I started smoking weed and drinking just to have fun, just to be social with my friends. I didn't think much of it. Who thinks that a little green plant could do anything to you? You know, people drink alcohol socially. But for me, that started to become more and more of my life. I started to ignore school. School actually became a place where I went to have fun. I would bring drugs to school. I would bring alcohol to school. My whole day consisted of going in and out of class, dodging the security guards, stuff like that. I really wish I didn't do that at the time because my teachers would pull me aside or my counselors would pull me aside and they'd be like, Mitchell, when you're in my classroom, you get everything, you get good grades. Why are you doing this? And I didn't have an answer for them. Excuse me. That went on for a little while. The school got fed up with my stuff and they expelled me. At that time, I went to an alternative high school. And I encountered people I never encountered before. From where I grew up, it's more country. It's not cities. There's cities surrounding the country area, but there was no big cities where I was living. But I started encountering kids from other walks of life, different things like that. And these kids would bring drugs to school to sell. They would bring weapons to school. There was always fights. So that woke me up a little bit, but that's where I got introduced to harder drugs. And I started using harder drugs to not deal with the reality of what I was getting distracted from, because I had no longer went to school to go to school, to learn, to go to college. I no longer played sports, because when you're getting high, how are you gonna play sports? You look silly. I got kicked out of that school. And oh, by the way, when I mean hard drugs, I started doing heroin there. I started doing cocaine at that school. I was about 15 or 16 years old. Still didn't think much of it. I got expelled from that alternative school and they sent me back to my original high school. And I did the same exact stuff. And it was really fast this time. I got expelled even faster. They kicked me out of school. Now I'm about 16 years old. Nothing to do all day. I get high all day, that's all I do, I have fun. Somehow during this time I managed to get my GED. I just walked into the place, took the test, I didn't study or nothing, got aced it. So that allowed me to get into college. So I'm living this sort of like destructive life, but I'm also functioning in some way, and I'm going to college and I'm working. Then my father passed away of a sudden heart attack in 2003. And that's when I really started to abuse drugs hard, harder than I was already doing. And I used it to cover up the reality of what was going on, like what I had turned my life into. My father had died. I didn't want to deal with that emotions, so I got high. And I took it to the max. I was doing heroin. Heroin's sort of like a downer. It makes you feel good. That's what it does. It makes you feel good. So I spent all my money on doing this. I stopped going to work. I stopped going to college. That's what I did all day. I went to the city to go get drugs, get high, come back, go to the city again, get high. Eventually, I ran out of stuff to sell. Stuff, because I wasn't working, I ran out of stuff to sell. I ran out of money for my job. So I started doing petty crimes. And that wasn't enough for me. I was at the end of my road one day. I had no other source of income. So I took a rifle into a store and robbed it. Now, this was something I never, ever thought I would do. It's not in my character. When I was sitting where you guys are sitting, I don't believe anybody will raise your hand and say, you think you're going to rob a store someday. And I never thought that. But drugs brought that out. I don't know how it took. It took small steps, smoking weed and drinking. It was all small steps, but all steps that I had taken to get to the point where I was at. And I never thought that that would happen. Right now, I'm doing 10 years in prison, so I've lost my whole 20s. I'm 27 now. There's things out there that I don't even, like, I've never been on Facebook. I've never, you know, touched phone. I don't know anything about that stuff. I just want you guys to stay on the positive path of what you're doing, with what you're doing here. You know, you guys are about to graduate. The 11th graders, you guys are going to be graduating next year. Stick with that stuff. If you like sports, stay with the sports, because the way that I went, obviously it doesn't work. I'm in a prison uniform now, and prison really isn't fun. Just imagine having almost no contact with the outside world, writing letters. You don't have no cell phone, no internet. You're not allowed to access the internet. Just cut the students that went through this 24-hour, 32-hour process, they sort of lived one day in prison. They didn't have contact with anybody. And that's what prison's like every day that you're in prison. Prison's a really bad place. You're not going to learn anything there. You're not going to make any money. It's the worst career move you could ever make. You will really lose your time. Like, I've seen horrible things in prison. I don't even know how I survived, but I managed to survive through it. But I just want you guys to just stick with the positive, because I'm proof. You can look at me as proof. I don't mind. It doesn't work. It doesn't work the way I did it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mitchell. You know, I'd like to point out the poster that we have on stage at this time. It says, the worst thing that you can do is to establish a criminal record. Avoid it at all costs. And I think this is very pertinent and relevant, because we have the juniors and seniors in the audience today. And I know you're starting to think about colleges in the fall and careers. I want to be very clear about something. Once someone has this criminal record, there are so many careers that you can never, never go into. And I'm not going to list them all, because quite frankly, we don't have the time. But just a few. One example, any field of law enforcement. Officer Jadis and Officer Lamro, two corrections officers here today. You cannot go into any field of law enforcement, whether it's corrections, police department. We have the police officers and detectives here. Police department, corrections, FBI, DA, any of that stuff. Firefighter, you cannot go into the military. You can never become a teacher in a public school in the state of New Jersey once you have a criminal record. You can never become a stockbroker in the city. You can never become an attorney, a doctor. In addition, we have a website, njdoc.gov. If you log on to our website and type in someone's name, if they've been to prison, their picture comes right up on the screen. And next to their picture, it does not say anything funny or anything nice or anything cool. In fact, it doesn't even say like Project Pride for our presenters here today. It does state the crime that this person was convicted of, the county where that crime took place, and where they're presently staying. And even when that person finishes their prison sentence and they get to go home to restart their life, hopefully in a positive manner, that information remains on that website. It will never, ever go away. So 20 years, 30 years, 50 years from now, someone could log on. This is not just for law enforcement personnel or for school personnel. This is anyone who has access to the internet can log on to see if someone has a criminal record. It's that serious. Now, our next presenter, her name is Faith. And when Faith was growing up, she also, like Mitchell, was involved with a lot of different activities. She was involved with dance and involved with gymnastics. And as she's going to discuss briefly today with us, she did not come from the best of homes, but nevertheless, a very bright person, and she still had choices to make. Yet, unfortunately, like Mitchell, she did not make good decisions. In fact, she made very unhealthy choices that started pretty young, where now she is presently serving a 5-year prison sentence at the only female prison in the state of New Jersey. It's called the Edna Mann Facility for Women. It's located in Clinton, New Jersey. Let's give Faith a nice round of applause, please. Faith.
How's everyone doing? This is a pretty powerful thing you guys got going on here. I was actually crying back there, trying to hold it together. But like Mike said, I'm serving 5 years in prison. I've been locked up for 2 years, and it's been the worst 2 years of my life. Like he said, I grew up not in the best of homes with my mother and my father in Ocean County. They were both alcoholics, and when they drank, they were not nice. They used to, you know, yell at me, hit me, whatever. And so it just wasn't comfortable living there. And it was like that till I was about 9 years old, and they separated because they just could never get along. I blame myself for it because I just thought like that they hated me because the way that they treated me whenever they were drinking, and that I always caused them to fight because of the things that they would say to me. My father moved out, and I lived just with my mother and my younger sister. My mother started going out and drinking even more, going out to the bars, whatever, and she would leave me with my cousin who lived down the street from us, and she would go out with my aunt and my uncle to the bars, whatever. He was always babysitting us. And in that time, my cousin started molesting me for like 2 years while he was babysitting us and my mom was out drinking. And that's when, you know, I kind of got like really messed up in the head because I didn't know really what to do about it, what to say, or really what was going on. I was 9 years old. So I quit like gymnastics, I quit dancing, I quit doing anything that was really healthy for me and started doing everything that was unhealthy for me. I started hanging out with the older kids in the neighborhood, started smoking cigarettes. I started smoking weed once I was going into middle school, drinking alcohol, you know, just doing everything wrong. So I didn't talk about it, I didn't tell anybody about it, until I went into high school and I tried to commit suicide 2 times, and I got put into a hospital and put into therapy. And the therapist kind of finally pulled it out of me, and she told my mother. But I still didn't want to talk about it. I didn't want to take the medications that they were trying to make me take, like the antidepressants and stuff, because I didn't want to believe that there was something wrong with me, something different, that I was different from everybody else. And, you know, whatever, I just didn't want to be different. So I didn't take the medication. I didn't want to believe that I had to take a pill every day just to be normal. So I continued to drink, smoke weed, experiment with other drugs, like ecstasy pills and stuff like that. And my grades like really started slipping. I started skipping school, skipping classes, smoking weed in the woods at school. And I got kicked out of high school. Eventually, I got put on probation because I was stealing from stores and hanging around the wrong people. I got accused of stealing a car that I didn't even steal. And I violated probation because I didn't do anything that they told me to do. had to go to juvie and a rehab because I kept failing all my drug tests. And so I came home and I started doing better because I stopped doing drugs, but I continued to drink alcohol because I thought that alcohol is not a drug and it's not going to get me in trouble, but it did. I still was getting arrested for being drunk in public, disorderly conduct, because I just used to act really insane when I drank. And eventually I caught my first felony charge being drunk out in Seaside Heights, and I assaulted a police officer. I got aggravated assault on a police officer charge, and I got 2 years probation. And I almost completed the probation till I started doing drugs again. Stupidest mistake I ever made in my life. I started taking painkillers. Percocets led to Roxy's. Roxy's led to OxyContin. OxyContin eventually led to heroin. At 25 years old, I picked up a heroin habit, and my life went completely down the drains. I ended up, I got my cosmetology license when I was 20 after I graduated high school and everything. Like those 5 years, I was actually doing the right thing with myself, working and all that stuff. So I went from managing a hair salon, making over $1,000 a week, to shooting heroin, stealing all my family's money, breaking into my mother's house, robbing her, robbing my father's credit cards, stealing money off of there, robbing stores. And eventually, I got locked up for robbing my mother and stealing her car and doing a high-speed chase with the police, and I got 5 years in prison for it. But since I've been in prison, this is like really the main point of my story. I've been in prison, and it's like the worst time of my life because I've lost so much. My best friend that I've been friends with since I'm 4 years old has gotten married. I couldn't be there. I was supposed to be the maid of honor in her wedding. She had her first baby that I was supposed to be the godmother. The baby has a different godmother. My sister hasn't spoke to me in 2 years. And then my father, who ended up, like, even though he was like a real jerk when I was a child, ended up being like a really positive person in my life when I came to prison because he got clean from alcohol and had 15 years sober. And that's who I was living with before I got locked up. He ended up catching pneumonia, and when he was in the hospital with pneumonia, they found cancer cells in his lungs. And I couldn't talk to him because his phone got shut off. And so I didn't know that he was that sick until the day that he passed away. My mother called up and told the social worker at the prison that he was dying. So like she tried to get me down to the hospital to have a bedside visit with him, because you can either do that or you can go to the funeral. You can do one or the other, and you have to pay a lot of money to go. But by the time the social worker called me down to talk about it, my father was dead. So I couldn't go see him, and then I refused to go to the funeral because the way they do it is you have to go in handcuffs and shackles, and you can just stare at the body in the casket for 20 minutes, and then you have to leave with an officer that, you know, you don't know, and that's it. You don't get to see your family, you don't get to hug your family, nothing. And that wasn't like my ideal way of saying goodbye to my father. So for the past 9 months, like, I've been dealing with not being able to have closure with my father passing away. And that's why, like, this is really like crazy for me, seeing this casket and everything, because like that's really all it brought back to me, was like losing my father. And it's really tough because I would give everything back. Like, nothing is worth it not being able to be there for my father. Not one drink of alcohol, not one hit of weed, not one party that I went to, nothing is worth not being able to be there for my father that week that he was sick in the hospital, dying. So, like, that's just, like, the message that I want to give to you guys. Like, it's not worth it. It might be fun when you're doing it, but like in the end, it's not, nothing is worth it. It's not. Like, if something like this happens to you, and you'll regret it for the rest of your lives. And that's really all I got.
All right. Thank you, Faith. Appreciate it. You know, I'd like to make the point now that obviously we are hearing from these three presenters here today, and I remarked at the or during the introduction that in a moment, or in about a half hour or so, the presenters will have to go back with the officers back to state prison. And obviously now that the presenters are sober and they're not using drugs, they volunteered to come out here and do something very healthy and very positive. However, they have to go back and live amongst people that the officers would never bring out here for Project Pride, for the safety of your community, the safety of everyone, for that matter. And there is not a separate wing in the jail or a separate building. If you're from Berkeley Heights or from Mountainside and, geez, you just made a split-second bad decision and you regret it and you're sorry, so, you know, the officers are going to put you in the nice part of the prison. Or now that you understand you made some bad decisions, you didn't listen to your mom and dad, you didn't listen to your teachers, right, counselors, so now you get it. Okay, please put me in the nice part of the prison. No such thing. The three presenters here, the three speakers, will have to go back, as I said, and live amongst people that we would never, ever bring out here for Project Pride. These people here are the minority, meaning that they actually care and they want to come back and make a difference. They're surrounded by people that are just the opposite. Some very, very awful, awful people. So, again, we're hoping that this is not scared straight. No one's here trying to scare you about prison life, but just the reality of their situation now, and as you're hearing, it all started back when they were in your shoes. Now, our final presenter, her name is Jessica, and Jessica was a gifted athlete. In fact, when she was a freshman, she started varsity. You know, she had many, many different opportunities. Very bright, did very well in school, but unfortunately also about her high school years, she started to make some bad decisions, and they obviously have caught up to her as well, where now she is presently serving a 3-year prison sentence. As I said, we only have the one female facility. Her name is Jessica. Let's give her a nice round of applause. Jessica.
Hello, everyone. How's everyone doing? Can you guys hear me? All right. Yeah, this is a really intense program you guys got going on. I wish they had something like this when I was in high school. Looking at this casket, it just brings back a lot of stuff and, you know, kind of like faith, and I'll get into that when I tell you guys my story. You know, like Mr. Ritter said, my name is Jessica, I'm 25. I'm doing a 3-year prison sentence. Growing up, I had a pretty good childhood for the most part. My parents got divorced when I was 3, but they were both still in my life. My mother, on the other hand, you know, she was an alcoholic, and she still is to this day. So that's really hard. It was really hard growing up with her, but my dad, you know, he was really supportive. He still is. I did really good in school. I got good grades. I was on the honor roll. I really liked school growing up, you know. I liked it. I really did. Probably about 12 years old is kind of when my life really started going downhill. I grew up in a really tight-knit family. I had, you know, a really close family, and I grew up with 3 cousins. It was my mom's sister's kids, and we all grew up together. They were all older than me, and I'm the only girl. So, you know, I always wanted to hang out with my older cousins. They were like brothers to me and stuff, because I was the youngest one, and, you know, I just wanted my older cousin's attention. That's just what I wanted. And the one cousin, the oldest one, Jeffrey, ended up molesting me when I was 12, and I have never told a soul until recently, and now I'm 25. It's still hard to, you know, it's hard to talk about, because I suppressed it for so long. I made myself believe that it never happened, really. And that's exactly what I did, because I still continued going to family functions, you know, really up until I went to prison. His kids, he's got 2 kids now. You know, they're both my godchildren. I just didn't want to believe that it ever happened, because that's my family. You know, I felt dirty, I felt different, I felt like nobody would ever understand my pain. So the youngest of the three, Casey, when I was 13, me and him were the closest because we were the closest in age. He ended up passing away of a heroin overdose. He was 16. None of us knew that he was doing drugs. We had no idea. So when it happened, it was really sudden. For me, it was really hard because he was the only one that knew what was going on. He had walked in after the fact of me being molested. So he was the only one that knew. So when he passed away, I felt like my secret kind of died with him. And then I really didn't want to say anything. You know, he always like stuck up for me and had my back. And when he died, I just didn't care. I just suppressed it. So that's really when my life became just horrible. I started smoking weed. I started drinking. My mom didn't help. She used to make us drinks and stuff like that at home. She would have my friends over. It wasn't good. High school, you know, I still managed to get decent grades. They did slip because I just wanted to hang out with my friends and party. That's all I wanted to do. So, you know, they slipped, but I ended up graduating high school. I went to beauty school after that. I went to be an esthetician, and I ended up failing the written test by like 2 points when I went and took my state board test. And instead of going back and taking it again, like I should have, like any, you know, I just should have did it. It was by 2 points. I knew I would have got it the next time, but I didn't care. It wasn't my priority. I just wanted to smoke weed. I started becoming that type of person that would really do anything that you put in front of me. Cocaine, ecstasy, you know, just more and more alcohol, more and more weed. It didn't matter what it was. I wanted to numb everything. I didn't want to feel. And I really feel like it stemmed from me not talking about anything that happened to me as a child. So I did that. I got an apartment with my best friend. I moved out of my mom's. I couldn't take her anymore, so I moved out. And it just became worse. I was working. I was pretty much just working just to pay for the drugs and the alcohol, to have parties all the time. And then I was introduced to this guy who was actually my co-defendant. He introduced me to OxyContin and painkillers. That eventually had me doing heroin. I started doing things that I never thought I would do. You know, like Mitchell and Faith, I started selling jewelry. I stole jewelry and money from my grandparents. And I don't think I mentioned, but I have a younger brother. I stole money from him, my parents, everybody. I didn't care who I hurt. I needed to do anything I had to do to get those drugs. So one night, we had no means to get any money. You know, no means to get any of the drugs. So my co-defendant decided that he wanted to go into a CVS pharmacy and rob them. He ended up going in there with a knife. He threatened the pharmacist's life and got all their OxyContins. I just happened to be sitting in the car when all this happened. My co-defendant ended up getting deported out of the country. He was from a different country. He wasn't born here. He had prior felonies, so they were done with him. They just wanted him out of here. And his punishment is that he can never come back to the U.S. And I got a 3 with an 85. That means I got to do 2 years, 6 months, and 20 days off of that. And, you know, a lot of kids think that, you know, the first time being in trouble, you get probation, you know, you'll get PTI, something like that, just a slap on the wrist. Well, I didn't get that. I've never been in trouble before. I should have been. I really should have been. Plenty of times I should have got caught, but I never did. By the grace of God, I never did. But I still got a prison sentence. You know, it's not worth it. And I think back now to like being a teenager and just wanting to hang out with my friends, not caring about school or my future or anything. I just wanted to live in the moment. And it's not worth it now. You know, we're all proof of that. We're standing in front of you in khakis, and it's no joke. One split decision can just alter your life. It's either death or jail. And you guys got to realize that no matter where you are, if you're at a party, you're in a car, somebody's got something illegal, you're drinking underage, if you can't say it's not yours, because if you're there, you're going to get in as much trouble as the next person. You know, I got conspiracy of armed robbery and a possession of a CDS. So it's just that easy. It's one split decision. And I always think back, I'm like, why did I get in that car? Why didn't I just stay home? But it was that one split second decision, and I decided to get in that car. So that's all it takes, guys. And thanks for listening to my story.
Feeling like any normal person would with the butterflies, a little bit nervous, especially the scope of this event. But it does make it so much easier when we have an audience such as yourselves. So I want to thank you for that. And I just want to follow up with some great points that Jessica made very briefly. We had a gentleman that was in Project Pride. He's not here today, but had a full scholarship to Virginia Tech University for football. He was at a party, and he had given one of his very, very close friends a pill. And they had done this a couple times prior, but his friend, when he took the pill, his friend passed away. So this gentleman, his name is Dean, he went from full scholarship Virginia Tech football player to Mountain View Prison, one of the prisons here in our state, serving 4 years. Strict liability for drug-induced death was his charge. And that's how quick it can happen. If you give somebody a beer, give them any type of drugs, anything, and God forbid that person gets sick, or, you know, like in Dean's case, his friend passed away, going to be, you know, held accountable. So it's very serious. I'm glad Jessica was able to share that. Okay, so what we're going to do right now, we have about 5 minutes or so, 7 minutes. And since you've been such a great audience, we've been able to move very fast here. We're going to get some questions for our presenters. Get some comments, your thoughts, your feelings. DOC has a lot of rules, right? But one major rule that we have is don't be shy. If you have a question, if you have a comment, something you'd like to share, something you'd like to ask one of the speakers, please feel free. Raise your hand, get involved, okay? That's why we're here. I also want to make sure we're on a first-name basis. Yeah, thank you. Make sure we're on a first-name basis with our presenters so you can address him or her by their first names, you know, appropriately and respectfully. And we'll see how good your memory is. Our first presenter that we heard from, of course, this afternoon, his name is? Mitchell. Mitchell, good. Our second presenter, her name is? Faith. And we just heard from? Jessica. All right. Okay, I'm going to come down here in the audience, get some questions. Please don't be shy. Don't be that guy or girl that walks out of here and says, you know, I had a question, but I didn't want to ask because I didn't want to stutter in front of my boyfriend or my girlfriend. Question right here. Okay. Your name, sir? John. Okay. Write down. Who's your question for? For Jessica. Okay.
Hi, Jess. Thanks for taking my question. I can't say that I understand what it's like to be incarcerated, but despite the regret that you have for being in jail right now, would you say that being incarcerated was something that you needed to get you off your habits, or would you rather not be in jail right now?
For a while, you know, when I was first getting sentenced, I had a lot of resentment towards my co-defendant. I didn't believe that I deserved to be in prison. And I still have some time, you know, some days where I think that, but in all honesty, coming to prison was probably the best thing to ever happen to me because it just picked me up off that path and put me someplace where I can't mess up. And I've learned a lot about myself. I've shared a lot of things that I would never even think about sharing. And I've done a lot of work on myself being in there.
Jessica, I have a follow-up question to that with regard to your friends or so-called friends. We know what happened with your ex-boyfriend or co-defendant. But your other friends that you were getting high with, drinking with, partying with, how many of those friends are there for you now? Like they have your back now?
None of them. I haven't heard from anybody since I've been incarcerated. They're all still doing their thing. you know, still partying, and the only people I have in my life that are 100% there for me is my family.
And Faith, same question to you. How many of the friends that you were using the drugs with, partying with, how many of those friends are still with you today?
None. Only my family.
Mitchell, same question.
It's not a year goes by where I don't hear from my mother or someone on that's on the outside world. Hey, Mitchell, such and such has died. And these are kids that I've grown up with. And we were partying together. And I just happened to take it to the extreme and get locked up. And they were still out there. And a lot of overdoses, my friends, a lot of overdoses. Even when I was on the streets before I came to prison, I went to 4 funerals. So the casket really creeps me out, but I've been there, and I don't really talk to too many friends. I mean, they're all negative influences, and I'm trying to do something good, so I don't really talk to them.
Okay, thank you. Another question or a comment for one of our speakers out here? Michelle? Yes, right here. Thank you. All right, good question. Mitchell, you got the mic. What's your plans, man, when you leave prison? What are you looking to do?
Plans are, well, I'd like to continue doing stuff like this if I could be used in any way for stuff like this. I'd like to get back into college. Obviously, I want to work and start regaining my life, you know, the life that I lost.
Okay, cool. Faith, your plans?
Well, I want to not do drugs and continue my education in cosmetology, maybe go back to school for something different.
Well, I want to go back to get that license that I never got. I also want to go back to school. I want to be a drug and alcohol counselor.
Jessica, you know we visit schools throughout the state of New Jersey, and oftentimes, maybe not in this type of session, but afterwards, students will come up to us and say, look, you know, I'm smoking marijuana or I'm drinking, but I see other people doing it. They're not going to prison. They're not dying from drinking or smoking marijuana. What's the big deal?
Honestly, that was me. I didn't think it was a big deal growing up when I was, you know, smoking weed and stuff. But in all reality, it might seem like something really small, but it leads to other things. You know, a lot of kids don't think it's a gateway drug and they're sick of hearing about it, but it really is. Because once you smoke weed, you know that there's something else out there that can make you feel better or whatever it is. So you're going to go to the next extreme. And then the next, and then the next, and eventually it's going to lead you to heroin, because that's exactly what it did for me.
Okay, thank you. Another question or comment? Yes, right here in the middle. Thank you. Yeah, please. Thank you. Mitchell, can you repeat that too? It's a good question.
Yeah, yeah, in prison, being that I'm trying to do positive things, and not everybody's like that. Is it difficult being in prison with all the negative atmosphere? Definitely. It's discouraging sometimes, but I never let it get to me. I kind of just let it go in one ear, out the other. I mean, you see people in prison that really don't care. Like, they want to get out and get back to gang banging, which or what they were doing on the streets, or selling drugs again, or there's even people that had problems with drugs and have literally plans on day one to get high. Like, they have plans. Like, it's crazy. The negative thing is bad. You see people with tattoos on between their eyes, on their necks. It's just crazy. But I just try to stay away from that at all costs.
Mitchell, if you could go back, we have an open seat right here. If you could go back, knowing what you know now, right, but go back to your junior year or even, yeah, let's say junior year. Go back to, you know, this seat right here. Would you have listened to someone from Project Pride, you think? Would you have taken notice of you know, what's happening here? Would it have sunk in for you?
At that age, I still wasn't listening to any good advice or anybody that was trying to point me in the right direction. I always thought I already knew everything. I really wish if it was like that, I would listen, because we all just shared our experiences, and it's real. And that's why we're up here. I mean, because you guys right now are sitting in the seats, so.
You know, I'm referring to the presenters by their first names, and actually that's a rarity, because in prison you're not referred to by your name. Typically, you're referred to by your number. So Mitchell, if you don't mind, can you tell us what your number is, and then Faith, and then Jessica?
My number is 424536D.
Yeah, Faith? Mind saying your
667926.
Thanks.
689806.
Let's give our presenters one more round of applause, if we could. Also, before I turn the microphone back to Matt, I would like to recognize you didn't hear from them during the presentation, yet without the officers, there is no Project Pride, there is no program, we wouldn't be here. So can we have a very nice round of applause for Officer Jadis, Officer at the Albert C. Wagner Correctional Facility. We also have Officer Lamro here today from the back there, Officer at the Edna Mann Facility. Thank you, everyone. Wish you sincerely the best of luck. Thank you.
Okay. All right, so we heard from like this end of the spectrum. I just want to invite up George Pizzo real quick to talk to you guys for a couple minutes from the parents' angle of this whole thing. So, Mr. Pizzo.
Just about 7 years ago, in July of 2005, my daughter, she was a graduate of Governor Livingston, sat in some of those seats many times, and she was walking home from, actually she was headed to her car from the Mount Carmel fireworks, and she was hit and killed by a drunk driver. So that's Amber. Fortunately, as great as this program is, and hopefully it at least causes you to think. But fortunately, we get our cell phones back. We go home and back to life as normal. In this case, it's no longer life as normal. It's over. Amber's life was taken from her. So think about, if nothing else, just think about what you went through over the last couple of days. Hopefully it'll help you to make the right decisions, what you heard today, because it's the choices that you make. Starting now, the choices that you make is what's going to affect your life for the rest of your life. Thank you all very much.
All right, guys. Well, we know that this like was long, so we appreciate like the respect and all that for all the presenters and everyone that spoke. So I think at this time, you guys are allowed to go back to your last period class. If you want, you can stay and talk to a couple of the presenters, a couple of the people that were a part of the program. But other than that, go back to your last period classes. Thanks, guys.